So I just did a live on Facebook, and halfway through, the comments were shut down. So I wasn't able to reach, I wasn't able to communicate with them. Usually we go through the comments and we have a discussion, and I wasn't able to do that. So that's interesting. Then I received a number of text messages saying, hey, mate, you know, I can't comment on your live video. Then I saw a post on my wall saying that weren't you just doing a Facebook Live? I can't see, so people can't see it now. You know, it's like it's limiting who can see the Facebook Lives. And I used to do a Facebook Live and I'd get like heaps of people watching. Now hardly any see it, you get notifications. It's a completely controlled system. You know, obviously I'm limited on how many how big a platform I can have. And I think because I'm talking about some deeper things and I'm trying to get people to think for themselves and contemplate what's really going on in their minds, they don't want people doing that. Now, it's if I was just doing videos showing police brutality or, you know, or I was focused on one thing, I'm sure I'd get a lot more views. I'm sure that I wouldn't be limited by YouTube and Facebook. And when I do share certain things, I notice that, you know, I'll get like 200-300 likes, especially when it's going in direct opposition to the narrative or it's going alongside the narrative. But if it's anything in the middle, it seems to not have any effect. So the narrative, because they want two sides, they want to build these two sides. And as long as both are fake paradigms, they're going to use them to extort the energy. And that energy is the energy that they're going to use to create whatever it is they want to create or destroy. Because, you know, if you destroy opposition, then there's, you know, you can divide the spoils. So anyway, that's just happened. I'm using the new computer that I've received from Peter. Peter gave me this computer. Thank you, Pete. You're an awesome bloke. You're a blessing. I'm really grateful. And also, you know, Naomi for organizing the fundraiser. And I don't need the money now for the computer because Peter's given me, he's given me two computers, two really good laptops. But I can get, you know, I can use that to pay for the VPNs. I can use it to pay for web hosting for my website and all the rest of it. So there's a lot of things I can do with that money now that can help. You know, you guys are a blessing. You guys are helping me to try and help others. I've got a desire to share things with people. Not everything I say is true, but I like to put a different idea. And I don't like to just say something different just for being different. If I see something that I think is wrong or something that I think needs to be expressed, like the legal maxim says, in order for a matter to be resolved, the matter has to be raised. So I'll raise the issue or the matter and say, hey, what about this? So that we can resolve, have some resolution there. I'm going to share screen and I want you to have a look. And this is what I was talking about on the live before, how waving a flag has become like the biggest crime now. It seems to be what have I done? I'm using a Mac, so I'm still learning. Now, if you have a look at this is Marty Focker's channel, and he does a real good job. He's right out there, boots on the ground, having a crack, and I like the spirit in which they go out and do things. You know, they're not like aggressive. They do this is right, and they're just going to do it. And whatever happens to them, they're happy to sacrifice themselves to show and illustrate the truth. They're happy to be the affidavit of truth. So let's have a look at what happens when these guys wave a flag.
I'm already being fined, thank you.
You're going to get fined again. Move the flag and go.
Move. I'm allowed to be here. It's all protesting.
It's a bit aggressive, wasn't it? I mean, all he was doing was peacefully protesting with a flag. But I think it was more the flag was the issue. Now, let's have a look at another one.
Listen, we found this product at $1.
Sorry about the ads. I can't do anything about the ads.
And we sold over 3,500.
All right, so this guy, okay, he's waving his flag. He's got his flag there, and look what happens. Now, he's not doing anything evil. He's just waving a flag, having fun. Oh, he's proud of who he is. You know, we got the American, English, and Australian flags. I mean, these are all, we're connected with these people. We're all English-speaking nations. We have the same values, right? There's no reason why this should be, an unlawful act. But have a look what happens to him. All right, so I got to say, I love that guy. He's pretty awesome. He's got his own way of going about it, and he's not, you know, he's not aggressive about it. He's just like, this is right, I'm going to do it, and he goes out and does it. Now, the police aren't very bright, and it's not. And bright doesn't mean you don't have the capacity to be intelligent. No, bright means bright. It's light. Okay. Let your light so shine before men that they can see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven, right? Light. We're meant to be light. Light synonymous with truth. And the reason the police aren't very bright is they're not given much truth, or they're not honorable, because the honor, they sell what's honorable. They sell their honor it's my job. I'm just doing my job. It's like, well, yeah, but you're sacrificing what's honest and true. And honest comes from the word honor, and you're sacrificing that for your money. It's selfishness. It's covetousness. It's sinfulness. It's iniquity, which is inequity. It's not equitable. And equity is the basis of all law. So the whole system is completely outside of law. You know, you can't communicate with them. And this is what's going on. Now, this is going to continue to go on. This is the way it's always been, because there's something, obviously something in a flag. Now, we've seen the flag has changed from the normal flag that we have. Originally, it was the red flag with the red ensign. Then it became the this blue Australian flag. So obviously that has connections to the sea. Then it's become a black flag, and I've seen it as a black flag with a blue line through it, which my research leads me to believe that's a sign of distress. But you know, I might be wrong. Why are they changing the flags, and why won't they allow us to share this information? I couldn't share this freely on Facebook earlier, you know, like a couple of hours ago. I got blocked from commenting and people commenting, and then it was restricted from people seeing it, because people were saying, I was watching your live and now I can't see it. Where is it? You know, so I'm getting text messages saying I can't comment on there. I can see it, but I can't comment. So why is it when I talk about these things that I get limited? And I was talking about, when this happened, I was talking about the communist Chinese flags being raised in the council buildings and in the police, on top of the police buildings from police stations. That's really been happening, you know. And I think people need to, you know, they need to recognize that this stuff's real. And if they're not learning, now what I might do, I'm just gonna have a look. Let's have a look. Let's have a look in Melbourne. See if I can get some images of it. Yeah, Box Hill Police Station. Here we go. So what I'll do, I'm just going to work out how to operate this a little bit better. All right. So here we go. Yeah, it's a police station. I don't know why that's... Anyway. Victoria, okay. Let's see if I can see the photos of this. Yeah, it's not letting me look at that for some reason. Victoria Police Raise, Communist Flag. Look at this. This is a picture of from the Herald Sun paper. Okay. Surrender. Victoria Police Raise the flag of Communist China. This really happened. This is a symbol. Well, I mean, what's a flag? What does a flag mean? If we have a look, you know, the word flag, to hang loose without stiffener becomes stiff. Where's it? The first. Usually a rectangular piece of fabric of distinctive design that is used as a symbol, as a signaling device, or as a decoration. A signal, okay? Think of flag, to flag something. You're flagging something down. You're flagging someone. I mean, it's a signal with a flag, especially to stop, a signal to stop. To mark or identify with, or as if with a flag. To call a penalty or penalize. Okay, you've been flagged. All right, so let's have a look at the etymology. A cloth ensign. It's sign. It's a sign. Okay, and it's got all these, its roots through the Germanic languages and Dutch, Swedish, but apparently recorded first in English, of unknown origin, but likely connected to flag or else independent. Yeah. All right. So let's have a look at some Bible verses here. And God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let it be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years. Now, the Australian flag has stars on there, right? So what, they're lights in the firmament. Okay, we have these lights. Okay, the moon's there as well. A lot of these flags have the moon, and some have the sun, some have stars. Ours has stars on there, right? And it says let them be for signs. And we just saw in the Webster's definition. The Webster's definition. It's a symbol, a signaling device, And in the etymology, it's a cloth ensign. It's a sign, right? Now, if you look in Revelation, look at this. It says, and another sign, okay, verse 3, appeared in heaven. Behold, a great red dragon with 7 heads and 10 horns, and on his heads 7 diadems, or seven crowns. His tail swept down a third of the stars of heaven. Heaven there just is the word sky, okay? What we see in the sky. This heaven is the sky. So there's something up there that we're not getting told. You know, we get told it's just space and there's giant gas giants. I don't believe any of that because, you know, all the people that have gone up there are either Freemasons or they've been proven to be liars. So I don't believe any of that stuff. And they indoctrinate the kids. Same as dinosaurs, you know, 65 million years old. Oh, yeah, all right, sure. All right. And you dug all those bones out of the ground and put them back together after 65 million years. And they think we're that stupid. All right. So, behold, a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns. Yeah. And his tail, see verse 4, his tail swept down a third of the stars of heaven and cast them to the earth. So, 33%, 33.3. And what's left over is a 66.6. Okay. It's funny, these numbers, too. They're in everything. They say the Earth tilts on an axis 33.3 degrees and 66.6. It's crazy. So what are the stars? So according to the Bible, the stars are, they're not giant gas. They're not big gas giants of light. That's not what they are. They're something else. Okay. And we just read that they're there to be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years. Now have a look at this. In Jude, chapter 1, verse 6. And the angels, which kept not their first estate, but left their own habitation, here the reserve for everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day. So the angels that left their first estate, where were this was their first estate? Well, I would assume it was in the heavens, in the sky. And they came down. The stars, even says the stars will fall from heaven. You know, so I don't know what the stars are. But I would think that the fact that we have them on our flags, and it seems to be the leading nations, many of them have, the ones that lead this whole world, many of them have stars on their flags. Then you've got these Bible verses that talk about Satan or the dragon dragging down with his tail a third of the stars of the sky, of the heaven, bringing them down to the earth. And then we've got all these mythologies of these beings that came down and, you know, and they gave us technology. And I mean, we know there were giants and all that sort of stuff. It's there. Like it's clearly in the Bible. It's in all the other, you know, ancient histories. It's in the cuneiform clay tablets from Sumeria. It's the Akkadian, all the Akkadian writings. So these things exist. They're real. You can look up the pictures of their skeletons, and you know. So how does it all? I just want people to be able to see what's real and what's and where the deception is. We've been lied to about everything. We get lied to through religion. People spend their whole lives in religion, trying to get close to God, but never getting really close, like in their mind. They have a real will and desire, but they don't learn the deeper stuff. They probably believe they are, but they're not. They're being limited. You know, most religions that I know of, that I've been involved in, they will have I'm a biblical man, so I've only been, you know, that's my faith, right? Is that's I try to conform my way of thinking to that to that book and to the to my conscience. And if they're in conflict, then I've got to work out why. Oftentimes it's that I don't understand what I'm reading. But they create a whole religion. There might be like, you know, a couple of hundred verses that they really focus on, and they omit all the rest. They read it, but they don't really study it. And then when you present them with something that's in contradiction, and you say, look, I know you believe that this verse teaches this, but it's not really what it teaches because of all these other verses that we never read and study in detail and we've talked about. But you find out pretty quickly whether these people really care about the truth by the way they respond to those kinds of, when you present them with that information. If you present that information, people go, yeah, you know, that's, yeah, wow, that you really are onto something. And they make an effort to work out and come to a resolution as to what's true and what's not, get to the heart of the matter, then you know that you've got honorable people that actually love the truth. But when you get people that go, oh, yeah, well, you know, sometimes they'll say things like, because I've done this a lot in a lot of different churches, they'll say, why are you bringing this up for? It's like, because I want to know the truth. Yeah, but why did you have to bring that up? You're just creating contention. What, because I want it, because I think there's something wrong in what we're being taught. I only think there's something wrong because I've read something that makes me believe that there's something wrong. And then I read something else and I've continued to look and I've found lots of problems. Why does that make me a contentious man? Well, it doesn't. It's because they want to make it a contention because they don't like the truth. So you find out pretty quickly that all these religions that use their, you know, they pick these verses and they use them in such a way and they manipulate people's minds. But we got all this, you know, this mythology of these beings that came down. You know, you've got the Kaaba stone, which is a black meteorite stone that the Islamic people walk around in circles. They walk around this black stone. Why do they do that? Why do they worship this black stone? What is it? And how's this? The Romans used to walk around a black stone as well, do the exact same ritual that the Muslims do around a black stone. And the god that they would worship, which was their belief, the being that they worship was being called Diana, and the symbol of Diana, believe it or not, was a crescent moon. It's the same stuff. And I think crescent moon with a sun or a star disc in there. So it's just a pattern. The patterns are still there. But what is this meteorite stone? And what's up in the sky? I don't believe the stars are ginormous gas giants. I don't believe that. There's so much evidence. Look into that. Have a look at people with really good cameras showing you things that don't add up with what we've been told. And there's just so much that doesn't make sense. And that's why we're so lost. Because if you've just got false information and you're built on that foundation in your mind, which is where the basis of truth is for all of your actions, then how are you going to come to a knowledge of who you are and what this whole place is, what it's all about? You know, I've talked about it being I might get the share screen off. I talked last week about the feudal system. And I mean, everything about us is a test. There's numerology in here, right? And I'm not saying like on the a satanic way, but like if you look, we've got five digits on our feet. We were created by a creator that made us that way. Why? What's the number five symbolize? What does it mean? Why have we got two nostrils, two eyes, two ears, two hands? They're the main basis for our sensations that go to our mind that define our thinking. I feel something, it's textures and things. I see, I hear, okay, and I smell. These, you know, and they're all, there's two nostrils, two eyes. Our mouth is a little bit different because our mouth, yes, we taste, but the majority of what our mouth does is it expresses what we put into here out. Okay. And that's where judgment comes from the mouth. Okay. So everything, every word we say is a type of judgment. I don't like that. I do like that. I'm going to do this today. So I like it. You know, I think you could do better than that. You know, I'm good at that sport. You know, I'm going to go and do this. See, it's all a judgment. We're making judgments based on stimulus, right? But then we have the feuds in our mind, right? Because the battlefield's our mind. So we have two eyes, two ears, two nostrils, two hands for the majority of our sensations that are connected to our mind. We put the information in there. We have to make a decision as to, you know, what we believe. We're going to balance it with judgment, and then we express out of our mouth, you know, which side we pick, because a lot of the time you'll be conflicted and you've got information, you've got to make a decision based on the stimulus and the information that's available. You've got to make a decision on that. So all of this is a testimony of who we are, and that we're created beings. And the feudal system is a dual system. Dual, D-U-A-L. And then you've got, but that creates the dual, D-U-E-L, the dual where they're fighting, which is your feudal system. There's two and there's two battling it out, the flesh and the spirit. Okay, the left hand and the right hand. Okay, left ear, right ear, left eye, right eye. If thy right eye or left eye or, you know, thy eye offend thee, which one is it? There's something in that we need to have a look at, and maybe you guys can comment and, you know, let me know what you think about this, these things that I'm saying. You know, I think that everything can be questioned, and there's a purpose to everything and a reasoning for it. Things aren't just because. You know, I know lots of people that just go, yeah, but why do you care about that? Well, I care about it because it's in front of me. And I think this world is a place where we need to ask the questions as to, you know, what is this world? Why? Because if we don't ask those questions, we can't, you know, what's the legal maxim? In order for a matter to be resolved, it has to be raised. So I'm raising the matter so that I can find out what the answers are. So I can know who I am, what I am, stand in the truth. That's what I want to do. What could be more important than standing in the truth and knowing the truth? I don't think anything is. What's more important than that? That's what we're meant. That's the battle. That's why they're going to convince you of the, of a lie all the time. The media, they want you to be scared and full of fear. They want you to be overpowered with those emotions, those thoughts, those spirits, because it's all spiritual. They want you to be brought down low. I'm so scared. And now I'm restricted. I'm put into this little cage. I've got to make a decision. No, you don't have to hearken to that. You can, if you get those feelings of dread, fear, worry, anxiety, just don't listen to them. Cast them. You can choose to not have them in your mind, or you can choose to hold on to them as though they're the most important thoughts and emotions to hold on to. There's many solutions, but you're not going to be able to, you know, access those remedies in the spiritual sense, which is in the mental, in your reality, if you're holding on to the false information, because that's going to cause you to be blinded by fear. Anyway, let's continue on. I want to show you some things that I wanted to show on my live, which I think I did, but I don't know if everybody saw it. All right, so Genesis, yeah, we went through those verses. Okay, star. What's the word star mean? Astrological sense of influence of planets and zodiac and human affairs is recorded in the mid-13th century. Is 13th century, hence the person's fate is figured in the stars. Ill Star-crossed, ill-fated. It's from Romeo and Juliet. Meaning, lead performer is from 1824. Okay. Star Turn, 1898. Okay. We see it all the time, you know. See, you've got the, you know, the stars. You know, the stars in Hollywood, the stars in the music industry, the sports stars, right? Star-studded. Stars all the time. Starring in this film. Starring. You know, you got emails, you can star them. Star. So why are these things there? What does it all represent? I mean, you know, there's a reason why it's on our flags. There's a reason why it's on there. It's not, and the reason they give us, I just don't believe it. I don't believe what the Freemasons tell us and what the truth is about this reality are very different, because their knowledge is their God. It's their power base. That's how they rule over us, with superior knowledge. Okay. So, and he said unto them, this is Yeshua, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Okay, as lightning. Oh, there's the, oh yeah, a natural luminous body visible in the sky, especially at night. Okay, here you go. Often a star-shaped ornament or medal worn as a badge of honor, authority, or rank, or as an insignia of an order. Isn't it funny, the order of Freemasonry, the all these things, they have these stars there. Order of the Eastern Star. A star. There's something about stars that we don't get told, and we see them everywhere. Stars are not giant gas. They're not these big giant light gas giants. They're not that. They couldn't be that. If you look into it, you're going to find out we're completely lied to about that. But we've got these, you know, if you look at the word, the meaning of the word, you look at, you know, stars in Hollywood, stars in sports, you know, we, you know, these people that have authority, jurisdictional power, have stars. They wear these stars. Masonry, they have stars. All right, so we just read that other verse, you know, this is Yeshua. He says, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. Satan as lightning. So lightning symbol is a symbol of Satan. So, which is why you see people like, you know, Freddie Mercury, you know, wearing his lightning. They make a deal with the devil. You know, people like David Bowie, you know, wearing these lightning over the one eye. You know, this is all in front of us. It's all there. Okay, where this world is run by symbols. Okay, and these people that run the world, they're evil. They're base people. They're not righteous people that run this world. The kingdoms of this world have become so corrupt now that we're gonna see it all basically get burned. It's the dividing of the wheat and the tares. If you can't see it, then, you know, I don't know what to tell you. The people are dividing. People are rising. People are going down lower. People are trying to find truth. They're looking for it. But the operating systems that exist in the public realm, which is owned by the Vatican anyway, it's all connected to the Vatican. All roads lead to Rome. They won't allow certain truths to be expressed. You can't express certain things if you're on Facebook or if you're on YouTube or any of the big platforms. You will be heavily censored. I've been heavily censored. You know, I used to share something and get, you know, 500 likes or whatever. Now, you know, if I share something about the Bible, you know, I saw the numbers going down rapidly, but then today they stopped people being able to even comment. And then people are messaging me and they're saying, I can't see your live video. What happened? But I can see it on my end. I'm like, well, it's still there. Why can't you see it? it's very obvious. That's what's happening. But, you know, a lot of people don't care about the truth. And the ones that don't care about the truth, they go, yeah, whatever. I just want to live my life and enjoy my life. Okay, well, I don't want to just live my life and enjoy my life. I want to learn what the truth is and who the creator is and who I am. And I want to be fighting against the enemy that tries to overcome my temple. And I want to keep it a clean temple for the creator. Get the truth in there. So I'm going to show you this video. And this is... you know, and you would have seen this before. It's been around for ages, but it's really obvious as to what's going on and what these people do that have a lot of power and influence over the minds of men.
What are you still doing? Why are you still out here?
Well, it goes back to the destiny thing. And I made a bargain with it, you know, a long time ago, and I'm holding up my hand.
What was your bargain?
To get where I am now.
Should I ask who you made the bargain with?
with the chief commander.
On this earth?
In this earth and then in the world we can't see.
You ever look at me?
So he just told the straight up truth. He said, I made a deal. Well, why are you still doing this? Why are you still going out there and performing and everything? He said, oh, I made a deal with it a long time ago and I'm holding up my end. What do you think that deal is? That deal's to the evil one. Okay, the one that was cast out of heaven like lightning. And he says, and he calls him the chief commander. And then the guy from 60 Minutes says, of this earth. And then Bob Dylan says, oh, and of the world we can't see, right? Let's hear that again.
What are you still doing? Why are you still out here?
Well, it goes back to the destiny thing. I made a bargain with it, you know, a long time ago. And I'm holding up my hand.
What was your bargain?
To get where I am now.
Should I ask who you made the bargain?
So he's made a deal with the enemy to get where he is now. And he makes his oath. And there are covens and witchcraft covens and all that exist. And they do it. They do things in the dark, in secret, so people don't know about it. And you can make these kinds of oaths, but they're... And you'll get the things you want in this life, in the flesh, but not the spiritual things of heaven, because the heaven, your mind is the higher place. It's the heaven. Now listen to this.
Should I ask who you made the bargain with?
with the chief commander
on this earth,
and then in the world we can't see.
There you have it, folks. He just told you he made a deal with the devil. You can choose to believe it, or you can choose to say, "Oh, and he didn't mean that." But they all tell you that. They all do. At some point, you know, all your famous music people say it, you know, they tell you that they do this. We're not meant to have any fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness. But we're going to reprove them, expose them. That's what I'm trying to do. Okay. I don't want to have any fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but I want to expose it and show you. And most people have probably seen that stuff. I just want to, you know, if you haven't, for those that haven't, and we can have a discussion about it, and, you know, in the comments as well, and just talk about it, because it needs to be expressed. Now, something else I wanted to bring up. Get rid of that. And let's have a look. Now, there's actually a number of verses here, but... This is in Isaiah chapter 11, verse 12. And he shall set up an ensign, so a sign, for the nations. We were talking about that because the flags are all always the whole world, except for one country, which is Nepal, have like a square, sort of a rectangular, like your paper that we use, a rectangle flag, square or rectangle, the majority of rectangle, and there's only one country that has a triangular flag, which is Nepal. Why does the whole world have the same type of flag? They have they have different images on there, different symbols, different star constellations, different things, different colors, but they all are operating like this. And those flags have four corners, right? Look at this, Isaiah. And he shall set up an ensign or a sign for the nations, and he shall assemble the outcasts of Israel and gather together the dispersed of Judah, which Israel and Judah are two different groups of people. Okay, so the Jews that are in a place called Israel, it's the wrong name. It should be called Judah, because Israel is not Judah. They're separated. They were separated, 2,700 years ago. And they've mixed in with all the other nations, but there's still a distinction between the groups, right? So he's going to gather together the outcasts of Israel and gather together the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth. See that? Four corners of the earth. You ever wonder why your paper has four corners on it? Because that's your world. You write on there, you make a contract, you create what's on the paper with words, okay? And how do you give it life, that image life? Well, you sign it. You become a signatory to the contract. It's the law of contracts, which is the law of the sea, which is, they say that, here we go again, they say the sea is two-thirds, 66.6% of the earth's, and then they say the land's 33.3, but I'm pretty sure that's what they say. They might have changed. I have heard that somewhere before. But then we've got those four corners of the earth. There's lots of scriptures that talk about the four parts of the earth, four corners of the earth. There's another one here in Acts. It says, and this is a vision where Peter has a vision where he sees all these beasts, and they're on this cloth, and there's four corners on it, and it was let down to the earth, right? These four corners. But it's interesting because it's a symbol of the nations of the earth. And he actually talks about it after. He says, I had a vision, and I know that to the gospel shall go, to all the nations shall go the gospel. So it represented the gospel going over the whole earth. That's what it represented. And, when we write something on these, within these four corners, it's a symbol of our contract. That's the creation. That's our world. We sign it. There's a reason why these things are written like that, on paper that has four corners. It's biblical, which means it's divine. Doesn't mean it's righteous the way that they use it. They're using biblical principles to do evil things. And because we're ignorant, we let them get away with it, because we're not rebutting any of these claims, and we're obligated to make a rebuttal of any false claim. That's why, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge in Hosea. It says my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge, and because they've rejected knowledge, God will reject us. Well, are people really, really interested in knowledge, knowing the truth? Well, I just told you before, how many people that I speak to ask me, why do you care about all this stuff? I had a conversation with a guy across the at the park. It's just by my place, and he said, why do you care so much, Nick? Just enjoy your life. Well, because I know that there's more to this world than just enjoying. There's more to this world than just doing stuff. knowing what the world is, who I am, and trying to be what the Creator made me to be, that to me is what it's about. Now, other people might be happy to do less and just go, I'm not that interested. I just want to enjoy my life. We only get one chance in this world to be a light, to stand up against the evil. And then once it's done, it's done. We're going to be judged for all of our actions, whether it's good or bad. We're going to be judged. And everything that we've done, that's going to be exposed. So that's why you need to repent, change your mindset, and learn. Become a new creature, new creation. Turn away from the evil way. And you know, don't be full of fear. That's an evil way. Don't be selfish. Don't be covetous. Don't sell your honor for some money now. I mean, it's a huge trade-off that the police make. You know, look, they do things that are completely against law. I don't care about this law of man crap that much. I don't really care ultimately, because it's not just, it's not honorable, it's not equitable. I care about God's law. That's the law that really matters. And our law shouldn't be so far inconsistent with God's law, but it is now. And there is inequity. There's not fairness. There's not equality. You know, they say that we have equality, and it's just deranged. It's psychotic. So, you know, we need to be aware of what the truth is, and who we are, and what we are, and be what we're meant to be. And then when it's all over, we're going to be judged for those things. And then we can stand before our Creator and say, I did my best. I did everything I could do. Imagine you get there and you say, oh, look, I would have done more, but I got a bit distracted with things. You know, my marriage didn't work out because I didn't really care that much about it. Or, you know, my kids went off the rails because I just didn't care that much about them. And I just put them in public school and let them do, you know, and let them play the games they want to play and watch the cartoons they watch, and let the state and the media control their minds. Or you can say, put the effort in, because you reap what you sow, and sow good seeds in those little ones. You know, you're, no matter what happens, if you've planted good seeds, they will grow, whether in this life or the next. You got to believe. If you don't believe in God, at least believe in good, because they're synonymous. What's good? But if you think that reality is whatever you make it, or that you're the only one you're the only one that really exists, then you know you're mistaken. Because there's enough out there that testifies to that being a false ideology. People are conscious around us. People, we have emotions that tell us that, you know, that tell us we need to love and care for people. But then we have this dueling between the flesh and the spirit. You know, you get angry and you get selfish and you're proud and vain and all these other things. And then you got the other side that says but you've got to pay everybody their dues. You've got to give them what's theirs. Everyone has a right to be happy. Okay, they have a right to choose a way that brings them joy. And I think there's a lot of confusion there. A lot of people want to do things that are just evil and think that they're going to get joy there. You don't get joy doing evil. If you sow bad seeds everywhere, you're not going to reap anything. And people believe that they are for some reason. There's a lot of people out there that think, you know, they can go around stealing from people. You know, like it just happened recently to a friend of mine. He built this massive platform, an amazing platform. And it's devoted to law and different ways to basically different solutions for protecting your rights and your assets. And he created this whole thing and he had like an agreement, and you know, the other bloke who was in the, you know, he was the other partner, who says he's not, they weren't partners, but they had an agreement, and he just decided to say, see you later to the guy that put all the effort into building this thing up. It's greed. People are greedy. They really are. You know, it'd be like if I started a gym with a partner and I said, look, I'll just do the coaching. I'm just going to coach. And the other partner says, all right, I'll do the marketing. I'll do the promotional. I'll do the design layout for everything. I'll do all of the other stuff. And you just do the coaching. And we'll have a split, whatever percentage it is. And then we start from scratch, you know, or with a very small membership base. And then we get to a large membership base where there's actually a lot of money. And then I was to say to the other guy, the other partner, look, I'm not really interested in having you here. I don't need you anymore. So see you later. Bye. I hope you do really well, but I'm not going to need you anymore. I'm going to take it all now. That's not right. It's not equity. But people are doing that. It happened to my friend just the other day. So this stuff does happen. It happens all the time. People covet what's not theirs. People care about themselves and not. There's two ways of looking at it. It's all about me, and trying to get what I can, or it's what I have, I need to give to others and help others because of love. If you have love for other people, you're going to give to them and help them, or you can not have love and you can be selfish, and it makes you very sick and very ill to be that way. And there's not a lot of power if you're at that base level of emotion. It's reptilian almost. It's like very animal-like. It's like predatory. What can I get? What can I get? What can I get? Me. Well, we should be looking at what can I do? You know, like the Bible verse says, you know, let he who is great among you be your servant. The system, the pyramid system we're in now, you've got the elites at the very top and it goes down, 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 down. Everyone at the bottom is working. And the guy at the top, the little group at the top, they're just got everyone else enslaved to provide for them. The way it's really meant to be is the one at the top serves, and it's a service pyramid. But the pyramid that we're in now is the opposite way. Okay, we're going to serve the few, not the few serving the many. And that's going to change. It's going to change soon. I don't know how long it's going to happen, because people are becoming aware of truth and people are picking their sides. And the stronger side is always the one that's in truth, because the light always, always overpowers the darkness. You turn the light on, the darkness goes. It has to. Okay. It's natural law. And just because the light, people think it's, you know, like truth, they don't see that the connection, how truth and light are the same thing. If I turn the light on in a room, I can see I can see everything in there. Oh, I know the computer's here, the books are behind me. Okay, I can see things. The windows are over there. I turn the light off, I can't see it. When you can see what's really happening, and you express it, people can then see it as well. You know. Why, you know, so asking the questions why and getting answers, the right answers, that's light. People can see it. It's the same thing. And remember, light's a spectrum. We can only see red, violet waves, right? We can only see a little part of the spectrum. There's a whole spectrum of light that we can't see, but we're still able to access it in different ways with our other senses and our higher self, you know, not the fleshly self, because that's the selfish one. That's the flesh that fights with the spirit. We want to be in the spirit. So anyway, guys, that's all I wanted to say and share with you. And you know, we got to choose the right way. Choose you this day who you will serve. As for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. I'm going to serve God. I'm going to go with God to them and do what I can. And if I do something wrong, I know that he'll understand and forgive me. Not understand, he'll inner stand where I'm at, because I'm a temple of the Holy Spirit, and he's going to know that, you know, you can make mistakes. We don't get condemned for making mistakes. We do get condemned for not trying and burying our talent in the earth and not using it. We're not meant to use it. And if we make a mistake, we make a mistake. And if we say, "Look, please help me, you know, so I can deliver the message of truth or so I can help these people," you know, we get asking, you shall receive, knocking, it shall be opened unto you. Okay, it really happens. If we ask for things that are righteous and good, he will give them to us. Doesn't mean it will happen immediately or necessarily the way that you want it to. Usually it will happen in a bigger way than we can comprehend, as long as it's not a selfish reason for a selfish purpose and we're not getting in the way. So on that note, I will I'll end this, and I hope to see you guys, you know, in the comments, and we can have a bit of a discussion about it. And next week we'll have another live on Zoom where we can have a sort of a real discussion. I just wasn't able to do one this week because it's just been a really, really tough week for us. All right, God bless.